Want a more fault-tolerant data center? Bring the availability of cloud computing inside your data center with the only server built from the cloud up.
Hello everyone and welcome to part two in our series of TechNet radio discussions for IT managers and business decision makers entitled Understanding BYOD, where we showcase solutions and technologies supporting computing device choice in business. My name is Kevin Remde and I'm a senior technology evangelist in the U.S. developer and platform evangelism team at Microsoft, and I'm your TechNet radio host today. Now today, once again, we'll be talking with Yuri Diogenes, Senior Knowledge Engineer at Data Center Devices and Enterprise Client Solutions Group, about BYOD. In part one of our discussion, we introduced and then addressed some of the big picture items around the topic, and the challenges and considerations of bring your own device policy in business. And today, Yuri's going to talk with us and talk us through some of the technologies for Microsoft and give us an introduction on some of their potential implementation. Welcome back, Yuri.
Hi, Kevin. Thanks for having me again. And the first episode was great. Today, I'm looking forward to continuing that discussion.
Absolutely. Well, so before we get into that, why don't you remind us a little bit about what you do at Microsoft?
So at Microsoft, I've been working for the past, I'm going to be 8 years in January at Microsoft. First 5 years were at CSS as a sports college engineer, primarily working with security products, and then I moved to the IX organization. Nowadays, I work in the solutions team, which is part of the DDEC, data center team that you said, CSI. And my team is responsible for putting together solutions for Microsoft technologies. Some of the solutions are related to hybrid cloud, cloud infrastructure, and now we're working on this BYOD considerations guide that also is going to be out there. So we work with many technologies, try to find a way to combine those technologies to resolve a problem.
Fantastic. And so for those of the folks that don't remember, BYOD stands for?
Bring your own device.
Bring your own device, absolutely. And it's pretty widely known now and certainly a big issue for a lot of businesses these days. And the last time we talked, you mentioned that you mentioned how a foundational aspect of managing devices that are owned by the end user is going to be providing some kind of way to actually know which devices are which. Somehow, no matter who owns the device, whether it's the business or the end user, if it's to be managed then granted some amount of rights for access into the corporate information, I need to know as an IT administrator that that device exists. So how do we accomplish this?
Well, you brought a very, very good point, because one of the challenges that IT has today is that they need to know something about the device. And as we know, until actually before Windows Server 2012 R2, the primarily way to manage and to know more about the device is by joining the device to the domain. And that's a very intrusive process. If you think about, I'm the user and I have a device, and hey, I don't want my device to get company policies, get hardening, you know, everything. And some users might think, well, it's going to mess up with my computer because now I have to obey users, the company policy, even if I'm home. Many users don't realize they can just switch profiles and then log off a different profile. So there is this whole problem there. So managing devices and keep data secure is primarily and is very important. So with Windows Server 2012 R2, what we have is something called the device registration, which is a very interesting feature because it creates a new way to handle these scenarios. So now I don't need to join my device domain. I can register the device, and IT now has some information about the device. It leaves the state of unknown device to known device. Now I have some information, some capabilities that I can report to. I have some way to identify which user is using which device and when he registered the device and things like that. That's one piece of the story. Now, all companies that really treat security as a very important aspect of their business, they want more than that. They perceive how good it is, the registration process, but they also want the management piece. And for the management piece, then you need something else called the device enrollment. While the device registration something is a capability built in on the platform, so Trinity of R2, the enrollment piece is not built in. It's actually you're going to need Windows Intune to perform this enrollment. The advantage with the enrollment is that it's not only a Windows thing. It's not only a Windows capability. You can enroll all the devices, and that way the IT is going to be able to do other things for the management capabilities, because what they really want is to understand the footprint of the device. They want to know how many iOS devices that I have in my company, what iOS versions that are running. I mean, things that they can report to. And not only that, but they also want to do things like remote wipe and capabilities that can keep the data secure in case the user lose the device, right? So they need the management layer on top of the platform. So that's important between, that's the big difference between the device registration and device enrollment. That's a very important thing to mention, because many talks that I had done in the past, they were very confused about registration and enrollment. They think registration means managed, and it is not fully managed, right? The IT knows the device, but cannot do a lot of things on the device yet until you enroll the device, and for that you need the second piece, which is Windows Intune.
All right, so let's just step back for a second and say that I'm in a company like 90% of the businesses out there. We're a company that uses Active Directory to manage and grant secured access for my users and computers, as we have done for many, many years. Kind of walk us through that process. How does a user-owned device get registered and then enrolled into such an environment?
So the device registration process, it happens natively in Windows 8.1, you have something called Workplace Join, which is the new way to put a device in a known state for the IT. You don't need to join, but you need join to the domain, the traditional domain join process. You now have the Workplace Join, which is a very light process, not very intrusive, because you're not going to receive all the policies and things like that. But what you actually do is you are creating a bind between the device itself and the user. The user that registered the device will have a record, a device record in Active Directory. And the device itself will receive a certificate. The thumbprint of that certificate will be registered on AD. So that way, next time that the user tries to use that device, which is already joined to the workplace, during the authentication process, I can validate if the device is really the device it says it is, and if the user that using the device is also the user that initially registered the device. You can play around with authentication and authorization rules if you have something in between, which in our case would be the ADFS. Because with ADFS, you can use the device as a second factor of authentication. User brings the device, and users try to access the device, and you can enforce policy and say, hey, you can only access if you register first. So if the device is not registered, it forces you to register. So you can do that from the user perspective, or even from the app's perspective, if you publish an app through the web application proxy, which is another role that we have new in Windows Server 2012 R2.
Hey, so Server 2012 R2, the newest version of Windows Server, and specifically improvements in Active Directory in R2 are going to allow the registration and then eventual enrollment of devices, and you said into registration natively as part of Windows Server. And you just mentioned something called this web application proxy. What is the purpose of that?
So the web application proxy is a new role in Windows Server 2012 R2, which allows you to publish apps, publish URLs. And the one of the biggest advantage of the web application proxy is that when you combine web application proxy with the ADFS, you can now do conditional access for granular control over the application that needs to be accessed. That way you can say, for example, if the user is bringing the device and the user is located at that moment outside of our corporate network, in other words, off-premise, coming from the cloud to access the application internally, then he needs to do, for example, a multi-factor authentication, right? So you can enforce different authentication levels according to the user's location. If the user is coming from corporate network, for example, he is physically log in and plug in on our wireless network, which I'm going to understand that as the intranet, so that he does not need to perform the multi-factor authentication. So the web application proxy will pretty much publish. It's a reverse proxy. It's a web application proxy by itself. It supports reverse proxy pass-through authentication using NTLM and basic authentication. And also, when you leverage ADFS, you can use claims and Kerberos. You can use off-force-based access authentication, RESTful off apps. So it really powerful, and you can leverage, for example, Windows Azure Active Directory as the authentication repository if you want to use web application proxy. So it's a very powerful thing. Since I come from the edge world, working many years with Forefront, TMG, ISO server, many customers and IT pros have asked me in the past if this is the new TMG or new UAG, and it is not. It has a very particular purpose in the BYOD scenario, which is publishing apps in combination with ADFS. So the power of web application proxy can only be perceived when you combine web application proxy with ADFS.
Okay, a very flexible tool, and it's easy to understand with that flexibility and some of the confusion around that, but I think you've done a really great job laying that out for us, so thank you. Now, so to recap, I have my own device, it's registered, it's enrolled at my company. I now have the ability to access secured applications and resources at my company through the web application proxy and from wherever I'm at, being able to have that access granted. Let's talk about something as seemingly simple as file access. My company documents, IT is securing those documents. They're managing that on my behalf for me or my team. And in the past, my domain login to my company-managed domain-joined PC allowed me to securely access, say, a document repository on a file server. And I could even set up offline folder access so I could have a local copy of those documents if I happen to be away from the corporate network. Mm-hmm. But now I'm using my personal non-domain joined computer, and I want to access those files. In fact, I'll take it a step further. Let's say I want to have those same offline, that same offline use of those files. Is that something I can do now?
Yeah, right now we have something called work folders, which is a very interesting capability. And again, we need to think nowadays, we need to think not only feature-wise, we need to think solution-wise. Work folder is a great feature that enable users to synchronize data from a file server to their own device, which is great. And you can enforce policies using work folders. For example, you're going to say that when you do the work folder synchronization, the data that resides on the device must be encrypted. So it's going to use EFS to encrypt that data. That is from the regulatory perspective is amazing, because now you have the data encrypted at rest, not only on your data center, but also on the user's device that he is carrying on all the time. Now, the work folder is natively available on Windows 8.1 when you do the work folder synchronization. But when you combine work folder with, for example, write management capability, then you have a scenario that is way more powerful, because now you can do RMS to the documents that get synchronized through the workflow desynchronization, which is great, because now I can say, hey, I have some files in this folder that users are going to synchronize with their devices. And I want to create RMS rules to say, if there is a file here with the keyword VNX or the keywords confidential or something like that, I can do keywords, I can do even regex rules to identify patterns within the file. Now I can enforce policies for the users that are using their device and accessing the data from their device. So I'm creating and classifying data on the fly as the users are synchronized, which is quite amazing. Now I can do this policy enforcement, not only for the domain join devices, but also for the device that were just workplace join. So workflow is a very powerful feature, but it's even more powerful when you combine with other capabilities like RMS. And again, what we do here to perform this access, let's say that users coming from the internet, from the cloud or whatever, you're gonna make available those folders using the web application proxy again. So you have that layer of verification of the URL using the web application proxy, and then you have the ADFS for authentication and authorization, and then you have the work folders. Now, one thing to remember is that the web application proxy is edge services, so you're going to put that in the edge of your network, and we recommend you to have a firewall in front of it, because the web application proxy should not face directly the internet. You must have a firewall in front of it. So you're going to have multiple layers of protection right there until you get to the file serves. And then when you get there, you do the synchronization, then you enforce the policies to the user's device. It's a very compelling story. I really like this capability because we evangelize a lot of people to use SharePoint to share files and everything, but we know that people really like to share files using folders. They like to access files within folders. They like the legacy way to access documents and spreadsheets and everything. So folders is a very important story for BYOD. If you don't have file services and share covering your strategy, there is something missing.
And you hinted at this earlier, but I just want to drive this point home too. Something interesting happens should that user leave the company. What happens to all those documents that are on their device?
Oh, you can do a selectively wipe on the device.
Selectively
wipe of the corporate data from the management device. Now, remember, this is a managed capability, so you're going to have the management layer with Windows Intune and System Center 2012R2, which is the management story on top of the foundation of the operating system. So when you do this procedure, which is not only when the user leaves the company, but let's say you work on the premise of need to know. So let's say that the user works on the financial department and he moved to HR. Now the apps and the data that he has on his device might not be the same, and he might not be even authorized to use when he moved to a different department. So IT now has the capability of say, hey, you are not allowed to have access to those apps anymore. You are not allowed to have access to that data anymore on your device. So I can do a selectively wipe and remove not only the data but also the apps from your device. And now you're going to enroll in a new policy to access HR data. So the selectively wipe can be done not only for device and for users that are leaving the company, but in situations that you are really serious about security and you are using the concept of need to know, and the user should only have access to that information that he needs. So selectively wipe is the way to go.
Wow, that's awesome. And it just really, it all depends on who the user is and what rights they have, and that enrollment, determining the rights in real time. And the added benefit, as you said, with RMS, to be able to, in real time, say, yes, this user has the rights to use this document, even if it exists currently on my system. I may not have the right to use it.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah. So now let's talk about the whole connectivity issue around this, because if I'm using, again, I'm using a device, let's say I need to access some kind of a resource or an application on the corporate network, so I actually require some kind of a VPN-like secure tunnel to gain access. Do I have a way of setting up that connection with just, do I have to have like a VPN connection that I connect first, or is there a better way to do that?
Well, our remote access story was we still very serious about using the direct access primarily to provide seamless access. Users turn on the computer and they are connected to the corporate. But some companies, they just are not ready to use direct access, or they don't like, for some reason, they prefer to use the traditional VPN where user must launch a VPN and access something. The problem with the traditional VPN is what I just said. Users have to interact and do something prior to access the app, and that sometimes generates calls to the call center just because users forget to launch the VPN and do the initial connection. So now with 2012R2, we have something new called automatic VPN connection that allows you to say, hey, this particular app requires corporate access in order to work properly. So when you configure this app, then you say, before access the app, go ahead and launch this VPN, authenticate, and then you access the app. So you defer the access to the app, access the VPN first, and then access the app. But this is done behind the scenes. User does not have to remember that he needs to launch first. He just double-click on the icon of the app, and the automatic VPN will be triggered in the background. During that time, the user might receive a pop-up window asking for authentication just because it's part of the VPN authentication process. If that authentication process means insert your smart card, he's going to have to insert his smart card. But again, it's something that is done only one time, and this time is when he launched the app. So it's a very interesting scenario, pretty simple, pretty straightforward, but it reduced the likelihood that help desk going to receive calls just because the user is not connected to the VPN, right?
Which is always a good thing.
Yes, exactly.
So we've discussed some of the new capabilities and leveraging these capabilities in Windows Server 2012 R2 Active Directory and the web application proxy, how we were supporting our secured users to access data and applications. And this is, of course, even while they're mobile. We haven't really yet addressed the issue specifically around identity. We've talked about it certainly as kind of an implied that we have identity management here. But ideally, as an end user, I want to be prompted for my password just one time. And I think you kind of just were talking about that. I know I'm not logged into the domain because I'm not a domain account, at least on my non-domain join machine. But at some point when I'm trying to access company data, I do need to be authenticated. So does Microsoft support a kind of a single sign-on for these domain secured resources supporting that for other managed resources, perhaps like Office 365 or other cloud-based applications?
Yeah, this is a very important point because we are marching to a hybrid IT world. People are moving slowly to the cloud. Some are using private clouds because they perceive the benefits of using the cloud capabilities on their network, but hybrid is really where we are leading to. We want to leverage some cloud resources and be in power and be in control of our on-premise capabilities such as identity. So IT has a challenge to manage identity from the on-premise perspective as well as from the cloud perspective. And users, as you said, they don't want to be prompted multiple times to type their password and things like that, and they don't want to memorize different passwords to access different things. So what we need to do is to be able to have a single authentication mechanism and, from the IT perspective, manage this from a single location. So what we do here is we can leverage the Windows Server Windows Azure Active Directory, WAD, right? Windows Azure Active Directory, to synchronize with the on-premise Windows Server Active Directory. So this synchronization of the cloud identity to the on-premise identity, it can be done in different ways. This either way is going to avoid the user to have to retype the password and things like that, right? But which way is better is best for you? It really depends on your requirements. So the first way is by using the dir sync with a password hash sync. It basically synchronizes the password hash between your AD on-premise and the Windows Azure Active Directory. Users, we're going to have a seamless experience when they are authenticating on-premise or in the cloud using Windows Azure Active Directory because the password is sync. The password hash is sync. And IT is going to have to manage this from a single location and use the dir sync tool. Now, some companies might still say, well, I really do not want to synchronize my password hash. This is against my company, my secure policy, and things like that. I really like the Windows Azure Active Directory, but I want to have control on-premise of everything related to identity. How can I solve this problem? Then you can leverage ADFS. You can do the federation authentication with single sign-on. You're going to still have to use the dir sync, but just to synchronize some attributes, and then use ADFS to perform the federation between the on-premise Windows Server Active Directory and the Windows Azure Active Directory. So it's a much more compelling solution for companies that are concerned about security and also for companies that want to have control over the identity on-premise. It's more complex. You need more pieces. You need more technology in place, like ADFS and dir sync. But the Windows Server 2012 R2 make it way easier to implement, and dir sync is just pretty straightforward to manage. So that's pretty much how you resolve the problem, even if you have some secure requirements in place.
Very good. Very good. Now, what other forms of authentication do we have? Or does this architecture support things such as multi-factor authentication?
Well, it does. And that's a very interesting thing because nowadays single-factor authentication is something that many companies are going away of having only passwords, right? They want to have an environment way more secure, and they really would like to offload the technology to a cloud service because two-factor authentication, when you have everything, the whole infrastructure on-premise, can be very costly to manage, to implement, to have personnel trained, to maintain, and all that stuff, operations and all that stuff. So when you leverage cloud servers, cloud services, to do the multi-factor authentication, then you have a win-win situation. And what we have with Microsoft is the Windows Azure multi-factor authentication. So it is a very interesting way that works because you can leverage your mobile device to receive a PIN number in order to provide the second factor authentication. So let's say a user tried to access a resource and he authenticates using his credential, and then right after he authenticates, it hits the service that he is trying to access, which triggers an action for a multi-factor authentication. At that time, the application goes to Windows Azure multi-factor authentication and say, hey, this user is trying to access this resource. Please send a challenge to him so he can type this challenge and perform the second factor authentication. And this challenge can be a text message on your smartphone, and then you type the text message, a number or whatever, and then you can log in. So it's a pretty cool thing. There are many companies already using technologies similar like that, and the Windows Azure multi-factor authentication or active authentication, which was previously called one factor, will allow you to do that.
Wow, that's amazing, and that's very, very powerful, very flexible, and I think anyone who is now finally able to bring their own device to work and have access to everything that they need to do with the authentication types that you mentioned, being able to be supported on the back end by the ability to work from anywhere and to know as a business that my information, that my company data and the applications are secured no matter where the user is or what their current status of employment is with my company. So it's all great stuff. This is a lot of great information. I really appreciate you sharing this with us, Yuri. It's a great story we have now.
Thank you very much. Thanks so much. Thanks for having me again. And it was great to be able to share this in these two series. I think our first first interview was great because it set up the whole conversation. Why BYOD, right? So I think it was a great sequence. Thank you very much.
And I'm sure you have other resources that we could our viewers would like to know about. So could you share those with us?
Sure. So for the main content that my team produces, you can find at technet.com/cloud. Most of our guidance and documentations are actually there. There are also some other resources such as the aka.ms/BYOD. Which will land into a page that talks more about BYOD devices and the strategy around that, and my my blog, blogs.technet.com/YuriDiogenes. You can find the slide deck, the complete slide deck that we are showing here in this episode. The full slide deck can be downloaded from there.
Fantastic. Good resources and good reference for future future work and planning as you're considering rolling out BYOD in your own businesses. Again, Yuri, thanks so much for your time today.
Oh, thank you, Kevin. Again, thank you for having me and thank you for the opportunity to be here again.
All right. And we'll see you all again soon for another edition of TechNet Radio, Understanding BYOD.